Hello all, in this video we will look at the performance of gradient descent for smooth strongly convex functions. We begin our discussion with strongly convex and smooth functions. We will see that the linear rate that we saw for quadratic problems is actually applicable to this much broader class of problems. For this purpose, we make this additional assumption that the function f is mu strongly convex. The quadratic functions are obviously an example of strongly convex and smooth functions with L equal to lambda max of Q and mu equal to lambda min of Q. And this way we generalize the definition of the condition number as kappa equal to L over mu. The result that we have is as follows. Under assumptions A2 and A3, which is that for L smooth and mu strongly convex functions, the oracle complexity is given by order kappa log B by epsilon. For eta equal to 2 by L plus mu. In other words, although we are considering a more general problem, the oracle complexity result and the choice of step size matches what we obtained for the quadratic case. Let us look at the proof. There are different proofs available in the literature, but I wrote this proof so that it is exactly the same outline as the proof that we earlier saw in the smooth and convex case. The first step is very similar. We subtract x star from the update equation and take norm square and then expand to get xt plus 1 minus x star norm square equal to xt minus x star norm square minus 2 eta inner product of gradient fxt comma xt minus x star plus eta square gradient norm square. Now in the smooth and convex case, we use the co-coercivity property. Here we will use the extended co-coercivity property, which if you recall was for strongly convex and smooth functions. Applied to xt and x star, it can be written as inner product of gradient fxt minus fx star comma xt minus x star greater than or equal to mu l by mu plus l norm square of xt minus x star plus 1 by mu plus l norm square of gradient fxt minus gradient fx star. Here of course remember that gradient fx star is 0, so these two terms can be removed. We can use this inequality by multiplying it with 2 eta so as to get 2 eta times gradient fxt inner product with xt and fx star greater than or equal to 2 eta mu l by mu plus l xt minus x star norm square plus 2 eta by mu plus l gradient norm square. Adding these two inequalities and cancelling some of the terms, we obtain the required one-step inequality as xt plus 1 minus x star norm square less than equal to 1 minus 2 eta mu l by mu plus l norm square of xt minus x star plus eta times eta minus 2 by mu plus l norm square of gradient fxt. Finally, in this case, we need to assume that eta is less than 2 by mu plus l, so that the last term becomes negative and can be dropped. Next, let us come to the step 2, which is the contraction bound. So at this stage, we already have the bound that xt plus 1 minus x star norm square is less than or equal to 1 minus 2 eta mu l by mu plus l times xt minus x star norm square. And if the term on the right hand is less than 1, then it becomes a contraction bound. If we apply this bound recursively and use the definition of B, the right hand side can be bounded as 1 minus 2 eta mu l by mu plus l raised to the power t times B. As earlier, in this case also we choose eta to be large, in fact as large as possible, so as to minimize the contraction term. Remember that we already assumed that eta was less than 2 by mu plus l, so we choose eta equal to 2 by mu plus l. And substituting it back, we see that the contraction term becomes L minus mu by L plus mu whole square, giving us the final bound xt plus 1 minus x star norm square less than or equal to L minus mu by L plus mu raised to the power 2t times B. Equating it to epsilon and then repeating the analysis as we did for the quadratic case, we again see that the oracle complexity is given by order of kappa log B by epsilon. For kappa much greater than 1. Recall that we said that while the oracle complexity bound uses square distance from the optimum. The optimality gap can also be bounded by using the inequality fxt minus fx star less than equal to l by 2 xt minus x star norm square, which is less than equal to l minus mu by l plus mu raised to the power 2t lb divided by 2. Another remark is that the oracle complexity can also be derived if instead of choosing eta to be constant, we use the backtracking line search. So that proof we will not cover here, and I will leave it as an exercise for you. A key point that we noticed when discussing both the proofs is that the oracle complexity is directly proportional to the condition number kappa. In fact, the oracle complexity of kappa log b by epsilon is only meaningfully better than sublinear rate obtained for the general convex and smooth case, as long as kappa is much, much less than 1 over epsilon. In other words, if kappa is very, very large, then the gains obtained from linear convergence are entirely offset. Let us look at some contour plots to appreciate the idea of what a condition number represents. For that purpose, consider the function fx equal to half of x transpose qx. And let us take Q to be a diagonal matrix with diagonal entries 1 and 5. That is, Q has two eigenvalues, 1 and 5. So you know that the larger eigenvalue corresponds to L, which is 5, and the smaller eigenvalue corresponds to mu, which is 1. And this implies that the condition number for this quadratic problem is equal to 5. Let us quickly look at the contour plot of this function, which looks like ellipses. The ellipses in this case are elongated because the diameter of the ellipses along the two directions are related to the corresponding eigenvalues. In fact, for general functions also, the condition number kappa equal to L by M can be related to the ratio of diameters of the sublevel sets in various dimensions. So whenever the condition number is large, it means that some of the sublevel sets would be very elongated and skewed. So in this case, there are two eigenvalues. So corresponding to the two eigenvalues, there are two eigenvectors, which is basically along each of the axes. So we can view the function from these two directions. As you can see, the function is okay when we look along one of the directions, but is quite flat when we look at from the other direction. When we take a gradient descent step, it provides us with a glimpse of the issues that come up in higher dimensions. When we decide a single step size, we expect that the progress will be similar in all dimensions. Now that would have been true if the function looked similar in all dimensions. But if the function looks flat in one of the dimensions, the step size along that direction will turn out to be too small. On the other hand, the step size would be too large along the other direction. So this is the key conundrum that we face in any scenario. The function is skewed differently in different directions, but since we are choosing only a single step size value, we have to be conservative and choose such that we do not overshoot in any directions. Now, backtracking can help a bit by choosing the best possible step size, but the fundamental issue here would still remain. We would always have a mismatch between how much progress we want to make in each of the directions. Suppose you do a coordinate transformation. That is, instead of operating in a given space, simply use a change of variables, x equal to tz, or equivalently z is equal to t inverse x, where t is some invertible matrix. Then the iterations in this space can be written as zt plus 1 equal to zt minus eta times gradient of g at zt, where we are defining the function g of z equal to f of tz, which is basically f of x. And therefore we can calculate gradient of gz as t transpose times gradient of f at tz, where gradient of f denotes the gradient of f with respect to its argument, not z. So the updates in the z space can be implemented as zt plus 1 equal to zt minus eta times t transpose gradient of f of t times zt. The advantage of operating in a different coordinate space would be that maybe in this space the function gz has a better condition number. For instance, if f is equal to half of x transpose qx for some arbitrary q, and suppose that we carry out a Cholesky decomposition of Q, which is given by L times L transpose, where L is a lower triangular matrix, then the choice T equal to L inverse transpose gives us GZ equal to half Z transpose T transpose Q TZ, and substituting Q, we get half Z transpose L inverse L L transpose inverse into Z, which is half of Z transpose Z. So we have a function whose condition number is equal to 1. Any kind of factorization can be used here. This particular approach of coordinate transformation is also called preconditioning, because if you multiply the update equation of Z with T, then you can see that we get XT plus 1 equal to XT minus eta times T into T transpose times gradient of F at XT. In other words, we are multiplying the gradient with some positive definite matrix P, which is T times T transpose, and that is called the preconditioning matrix. In other words, we are rotating and scaling the gradient so as to correct its skewness. However, in general, we do not know T, and there is no efficient way of finding out what T to use unless we have Hessian information about the function. And it is very rare that we can figure out a rule to select the transformation T which that works for a whole class of functions. So preconditioning or coordinate transformation is not a widely used method in the context of gradient descent. It is, however, used in some other approaches like conjugate gradient descent. So that is all for this video. We have seen the linear convergence for strongly convex functions. In the next video, we will explore the conditions which allow linear convergence beyond strong convexity.